what is the distribution of red versus blue by drawing some samples out of the graph. Is this Isabel with what he was explaining yesterday? No? The similarity in cosmology is, for example, you say a cosmic microwave background, and you want to infer from there the properties of all the rest of the stuff that is outside what you observe or outside this is the structure of the universe. And the same thing with galaxies, circles. You observe a given patch, you want to infer the properties of the whole. In the case you observe a particular survey, you want to infer the property of everything that is outside what you observe. Right? So it should be clear at this point in the graph that we are dealing with random variables, and that's what we went through the probabilities and the probabilities and all that yesterday. Today we are going to take a step beyond this and treat the entire distribution, for example, the galaxy distribution or the distribution of the galaxy. As a random theory. This is just, you don't have a single random variable, but you have a random variable at each point in space. And you want to have the tools to describe that. So, first of all, you want to keep in mind that any cosmological model that you may have, or you may come up with, would not tell you that particular galaxy is going to be there. It would tell you somewhat the average statistical properties of what you observe, but not the property of the particular realization you observe. On the other hand, you also have just for that particular realization. So it's important to keep in mind that you can define average statistical properties. And a particularly important quantity that you want to have in mind is the over density field, or the delta T over T. This is delta rho over rho. And so the example on which you really want to take the average would be all the possible realization of the two underlying universe. And then, but you need to infer that, you can't observe that. And all this relies on a cosmological principle that is that the universe is homogeneous on average, and in widely separated region of the universe, the density of the universe is different. That's why you can do that. And what you observe is a fair sample. Because if what you observe was not a fair sample, then there's no way you actually. So the tools that we're going to use are things like correlation functions, performance vector, and so on and so forth. So we need to characterize the probability distributions, and so far mostly they're the Gaussian number distribution, which we know and love. But that's not the only thing. You may know that in some cases distribution can have tails. This is an example of what we do with your schemas. Or distribution could be a factor of narrower than a Gaussian, and then in this case, those are the striker, and you can go on and on. So, what we define to describe the probability distribution are moments and components. In case you haven't heard about this, let's define them again. So, first, define averages. If you have a probability distribution and you want to find the average of some quantity f, then if you do the integral of f times the probability distribution, that will be the average vector. And then from there, you can generalize that to moments at central moments. Now, if your variable has zero mean, then of course it's a quantity. at the same. And I want to give you as an exercise to see if you understood things so far, to show that mu zero should be one. Everybody agrees with that? That comes from the normalization of the protein group. And that, well, mu one is the average. Yes. And mu two is the variance. Now, we have a simple way to distinguish Gaussian distribution from non-Gaussian distribution. So, for a Gaussian distribution, all moments of order higher than 2 are specified by mu1 and mu2. While non-Gaussian distribution have extrafysics, starting at order 3 and higher. These extrafysics are called moments. This one or this one? Or one more? This one.
How do you know that all moments of order higher than 2 are higher than the first moment?
Try.
Okay.
And you don't need time for that. So, try it out. I give you a few minutes. So, 0, 1, and 2, we just did it in our head. So, for you, the exercise to do 3 and 4, you may as well decide to take the x as a mean, as a mean. So what do you get at for n equal 3? Anybody? Is anybody trying? Anybody got them equal 4? Okay. So this is for a Gaussian distribution, the relation between central moment and cumulant for the first 6 orders. So for a Gaussian distribution, all moments of order higher than 2 are completely specified by the one. But for non-Gaussian, this keeps going. And every time you can get extra pieces. This is the balance, this is Q-A, this is the way to the process, and then you have the name for it. Yeah. Okay. So, what I introduce next, it's a useful trick. I'm not going to promote this on the appropriate way, but then it's going to be useful here and later on, just for generating function. So what is the generating function? Well, you take, it looks a little bit like a Fourier transform. So if you have a probability distribution, then you say, well, let me take the average of e to the I k x. And that's your generating function. It looks a lot like a Fourier transform. So why do I do that? It is because if you now expand this exponential to get an infinite series, you may want to try to do that. You want to try? Shall we do it? Something looks like a Taylor's function of exponential. Yeah? You got something like that. Now, this is very useful. Because, how do you get the moment? The hint is, tell to the derivative of this quantity. What do you get? Sometimes it's very useful to have a tool like that. And then I give it to you as an exercise to do with a cocoon or whatever to see that you can get the cumulant by doing the same operation of the log of this. Galaxy survey. And this event, assume that you occur independently, which is not necessarily the case for the galaxy distribution, but you know, we'll get back to that later. The probability that an event happens in an interval of a given length does not depend on where that interval is. In other words, this is random. The interval is time, then the probability does not depend. And things like this are, for example, a radioactive decay, photon noise, but for those who want to do galaxy survey, the sharp noise is moderate. So, we can derive now the questions, knowing what we say qualitatively about the distribution. So let's see how we can go about all that. So, using the derivative, so how do we do that? So you have a distribution, you grid it. And now you do the grid that is fine enough that in each cell you have either zero or one object. And now you know that you can only have the probability of having one object is rho by 3, which is the size of the cell, and rho is the average density of points, right? And the probability of getting none is 1 minus that. Since you only have 0 or 1, that's all there is. Now you can write the generative function. Because this n now goes 0, 1. Try. Start from one cell. So you should get something that looks like this. Exactly. These come from that, then these two are here, then zero, if you're zero is equal to one, and this is going to be 1. Okay, good. Now, you want to warm up that for a volume V with cells of size d delta V, where there are V over delta V cells. And for this for this application, you want to use the fact that for independent probability you can multiply the generative function. So you should take this. Then the size is small and expand. With the substitution of rho v equal lambda, you find the positive solution. Okay, now to play around with this a little bit, I will let you show that for that distribution we just found, the average of g lambda sigma squared is sorry? This is going to be online anyway.
Okay.
This is all going to be online. Okay, so why is this leadership not given? Okay, but let's just say something about that. So the superposition of many independent and identical distributed random variable would be approximately Gaussian distributed, but Alan will go through this. What I want to do instead, I would like to show, to discuss a little bit this. So we have a theorem, the central theorem that you have. If you have many independent things and put them all together, then you have a theorem that says in the limit of infinite of this, and under very mild condition, your distribution is going to end up by Gaussian. You may start with something completely else, some enough events, and the distribution is going to be Gaussian. So now you can say why keep going on the example showing Gaussian distribution. Because you hope that with the superposition of many, you will end up in a Gaussian. The other reason why cosmology Gaussian distribution are so important and Gaussian random fields are most important is because, well, this is pretty much a really good approximation of Gaussian random field. In other words, we believe that the initial conditions of the universe were Gaussian random field. This is basically what is seen in the cosmological background, but what is seen later on is something that is evolution of the gravity of an initial Gaussian random. So it is something that we can have some hope to describe and to understand. Analytically, you need some help with your computer, but at least understand. And the other reason why I keep going back to the Gaussian distribution, it's because of this. So this is simulation, and body simulation describing the late time distribution of the dark matter. And you can see this is obviously not Gaussian. And we can understand why the events are Gaussian. We start off with, even if you start off with a Gaussian distribution, then gravity is an attractive force. Things can become as dense as they want, but they can become rather less than empty. So you're going to develop some Gaussian. But the great thing is that if you take this and you smooth it, that means you look at the very large scales, what you end up having is something that is pretty much Gaussian. If you smooth with a space that is large enough, you end up with something else. Of course, you lose information because there's a heck of a lot of information here that you may want to extract if you are able to. But if you are going for simplicity, then you can just look at larger scales. And it didn't have to be like that. But since gravity is a play, it happens like that. So that's good. So let's say something about Gaussian random fields. They are so important. So if delta is a Gaussian random field with average 0, its probability distribution is given by the usual multivariate Gaussian, which we have seen already many times. And useful things to do is to Fourier transform this. So you have a field, a realization is Gaussian, space. Now you Fourier transform it. What is this distribution going to be? Well, in 1D we know that Gaussian in real space is still a Gaussian in real space. And the same thing holds in higher dimensions. So for the present people here, 3 is good enough. So what you should get is that also you get Gaussian. So if you try to do that, you should find that you have to write the real and imaginary part of your delta, which is now a delta of k, not a delta of x. But you will find that the real and imaginary part of the Fourier coefficient are randomly distributed in the domain. This is what this equation is telling you. Now, what I would like to try to do is to change this instead of using the real and imaginary part of delta k to write it in terms of an amplitude and a phase. and see what you get. So you remember the representation of a complex number, you can always say you have the imaginary part, but you also can say you have a modulus and then you have a phase. Did you get anything at all? Can you guess what happened to the phases of this? Exactly. So you find that the phase has nothing to do with the modulus, so the phase is just distributed randomly. And so that's why this is called the name of Gaussian random phases. Well, this is very useful, and now you can tell why we always tend to compress things and tell you what everything is and how it's working. Because if you have a Gaussian distribution, instead of the multivariate Gaussian random field inside a multivariate Gaussian, then there's no information in the phases. And therefore, the power spectrum uses all the rest of the information, throwing away the phases, but since there's no information in the phases, you compress all the information there. The moment where you don't have a Gaussian random field, the moment where there is some dependence on the phase, some dependence of the orientation, then this doesn't work anymore. Actually, in reality, I don't know if you have ever tried to do that, but I can pick out some images if you want. If you take a picture, most of the information, picture of something, most of the information is actually in the phase, it's not. It's just that if we keep saying that the initial conditions are Gaussian random field, then it's a very specific thing. All right. So it also follows that the average, the modulus of delta, follow what is called a Rayleigh distribution. And the other important property is, therefore, is that this quantity completely specifies your Gaussian random field. That's why I give the power spectrum then. Now, let's say your advisor comes to you and say, well, generate me a Gaussian random field. Just because it's similar to the initial condition for an air-body simulation, though for a real air-body simulation you can stop there and do something else after that. Or it's because, you know, I want to simulate what happened in my galaxy survey, but I don't want to run any air-body simulation. I'm interested only in the very large scales, and therefore the Gaussian random simulation should be there. Generate me Gaussian random field. How would you do it? Yeah, imagine that they say, I give you a power spectrum. So you generate the free space, put the basic sample, you give the amplitude, that distribution, and the color is going to go to one how to draw random number from the distribution you actually want. And then you Fourier transform it back, and then you give it to your advisor. And it's relatively fast to do that, so basically you can generate many realizations of Gaussian random field. It's much faster than any other simulation. So. I think if anybody wants to try on alpha, some of the mocks from the line on alpha at the beginning were done with the Gaussian realization, because you can make many, many, many measurements. Okay. Now, let me give you a counter example, because you may have read about this. Have you heard about the axis of evil? The anomalies in the cosmic microwave diagram. Okay, so the CMB sky, it's said that is weird. Now we can discuss later on what we mean exactly by weird. In the sense that there is what has been deemed to be an improbable alignment between known materials. So, this is an equal 4 and so on, and this seems that the power is always aligned in this direction. You could expect it to be more random, but all the atmosphere. And so this has been called the axis of evil. In a Gaussian field, not expected. Now, the big discussion here is what is the statistical significance of it. And I'm not going to open the discussion here, but it's so. Okay. Let me go back to this later. And go through. So I'm sure you have seen a depth with Fourier transform. And it's and you do Fourier transform on density field like a lot of time, so it's Now, different people do different convections for the Fourier transform normalization, so always be aware of what paper you are reading is actually using. You can get very confused. And also, you have heard about the two-point correlation function, and so we can write down here what is the definition of the two-point correlation function. This is the overdensity at position R, plus some displacement at the given separation, and then we can write this how it is related to delta k, delta k, and isotropy will tell you that the correlation function only depends on the modulus of that, not on the direction of that. And if it allows a field, it's a problem. And the power spectrum is related to the average of product of two deltas. And again, the same isotropy says that the power spectrum is only a function of the norm modulus of k and not its direction. Also, if you want to keep in mind that since delta 1 is real, then delta complex conjugate k is delta. Okay, so this implies that the power spectrum and the correlation function are related by Fourier transform. In other words, they are Fourier transform pairs. They are Fourier transform pairs that contain the same information. However, containing the the same information doesn't necessarily mean that that information is packed in the same way inside the relation function of the power system. Okay, so the other things that you may have heard here and there is things like the variance. So the variance is the average of the square of the correlation function at zero log, and it's defined if you go to the definition like this. It's sometimes written sigma squared like this, where this quantity now is independent of the Fourier transform convention. Now the question I'm asking you, I've written some very useful illuminating equations, but I have to tell you what scales they are defined. So of course there is intrinsic in here some sort of filtering. So if you put your field on a grid to do a fast Fourier transform at the point that you have this, then you are using the resolution of the grid, but you are not forced. So filters are being used. When you see the sigma 8 parameter, you know what the sigma 8 is, right? You're using top up filters of 8 megabytes, including just megabytes. And so typical choices of filter are Gaussian or top hat. Now, top hat is very nice to think about the top hat in real space. In Fourier space, of course, it's highly oscillatory. So the other very nice filter to have in mind is the Gaussian filter, because real space of Fourier space is very Gaussian. That's a cat with this leading feature. So if you want to ask yourself, when I measure sigma A, from what K that sigma A measurement come from, it's not a straightforward answer because this function is always C. So remember, convolution in real space is multiplication in Fourier space, and multiplication in real space is convolution in Fourier space. So when you apply a filter in real space, you are doing a convolution. When you apply it in Fourier space, it's not simple, it's just a multiplication. So the same information in the quantity in real or in Fourier space is there, but it's packed differently. In one case, the effect of the filter is very localized, in the other case, it comes through a convolution. Okay? Another thing that I may want you to think about is that in Fourier space, you end up having that the covariance of this multivariate Gaussian is actually diagonal. It's very nice, right? Because it's telling you that Fourier modes of Gaussian and Fourier are correlated. This is very nice because then you say that P of K1 and P of K2, delta of K1 and delta of K2. That's very useful. We have a very nice separation of states. So, okay, so the next thing I want to do is to discuss a little bit about the importance of the power spectrum. So I think it should be clear now why cosmology insists on giving you the power spectrum. If initially we are given from inflation a Gaussian dynamic field, that's completely specified by the power spectrum, and then this field will evolve under gravity, and although I haven't shown it to be mathematical, I assure it to you by taking the blur of the picture, the gravity evolves linearly, and field at small scales become Gaussian, but at large scale it still remains Gaussian, and then in Fourier space there is very nice separations of non-linear modes and still linear modes. So that's why we keep insisting on the power spectrum. power spectrum. It's also that theory, what the theory gives you on writing, it's a power spectrum rather than information. So usually, the power spectrum, those of you who are doing, for example, the project of the cosmological code for Markov chain for cosmology, etc., know that these are some of the parameters you put in, and this is one of the fixed quantity that you need to define. So the primordial power spectrum is defined like an amplitude and a power law, which depends on the spectral index, and this one is called a pivot point. This description sometimes gets generalized, and it gets generalized by something that is called the random spectral index. That's one of the other parameters that you may play with when Cosmo-NC runs, so the Cosmo-NC model. And so, however, whenever you do that, you always have to be aware of the choice this scale is this scale. Different users decide to use this scale at different values, and then of course things change. If I decide to use this quantity as, say, k at 0.03, parsecs, and you decide to do 0.05, we can't expect that this A is going to be the same if we have to describe the same power spectrum. And so, you want to be able to convert the amplitude of one K to the amplitude of the other K when you choose a different convection for the people. And you have carry along. So, now it's an exercise for you. How is n of k related to n of some k not at some period? And the hint is called that n here is d log p d log k. Oops. It's d log p d log k. Right. Write down n is below p below k, and then I go back to show you the other equations. I just want to go through this because I've seen mistakes very long here. And since it's a relatively simple thing to do, if you remember the definition, I didn't think you need to do this better. Thank you.
surprise and they were there right in the wall.
The organizers say that by the end of it, if you keep on going, you're going to be like spending all your money in prices. So the organizer says, right before a dancer on the board, you get a prize, so they will never know me. Right, you can sign. Okay, so let's have a break. We'll be breaking from writing submission on the breakfast, let's sign if you want to have double lunch.